Sir Muthuramanjan, please welcome, sir. Sir, this is Saranya. Am I audible?
Yeah, audible.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Sir, shall we start?
Yes. The screen is moving.
Kindly check.
The screen is moving.
Kindly check whether KC Chaudhary sir is joined or not.
Okay, the screen is moving. My slides are moving.
KC Chaudhary sir has joined.
Okay.
Saranya, you kindly check that.
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Hello, good morning to all of you. Shall we start this program?
Yes.
Yeah. Saranya.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, we start the program. Yes.
Sir, Venkat Ravi sir went for meeting the vice chancellor in charge.
No, vice chancellor has already joined. I was told.
Okay, sir. Let me start. We will start the proceedings with a prayer. Raghupati Raghavaraja Rampati Pavana Sitaram. Raghupati Raghavaraja Rampati Pavana Sitaram. Raghupati Raghavaraja Rampati Pavana Sitaram. Ishwara Allah Tere Naam. सबको सन्मति दे भगवान ईश्वर अल्लाह तेरे नाम सुको सन्मति दे भगवान भजन प्यारे राम रही भज मन प्यारे कृष्ण हरि भज मन प्यारे राम रही भज मन प्यारे कृष्ण हरि राम राम जय राजा राम 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 जय सीता राम 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 जय राजा राम 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 जय सीता राम 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 जय राजा राम 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 सीता राम ओम शांति 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 ओम The universities, colleges, research and training institutions are considered as higher education institutions which are engaged in teaching, research and extension in various disciplines and with interdisciplinary approach. The higher education institutions accumulate the scientific knowledge that need to be transferred to the grassroots level for the sustained socio-economic development. In this context, the extension and the community outreach program by the higher education institutions is vital in the process of technology transfer for sustainable development. The process is an important component in the lifelong learning from the field by the scientist and development professionals. It implies mutual transaction for mutual gain by higher education institutions community. In context, our department is organizing a series of invited special lectures on various dimensions of extension and community outreach by higher education institutions. The Gandhigram Rural Institute, in collaboration with the Indian Adult Education Association, New Delhi, which is the prime national level institution working for lifelong learning. The current series of lecture is being organized 8th, 9th, 10th of December 2021, covering vital theme of lifelong learning and extension. Amidst, we have Professor Raja, President, Indian Adult Education Association, New Delhi. And may I have request Professor Raja to deliver the welcome address on this occasion. Please, sir.
good morning to all of you. Namaste. Vanakkam. It gives me an immense pleasure today that the Department of Lifelong Learning, Gandhigram Rural Institute, and the Indian Adult Education Association, New Delhi, are jointly organizing these 3 days series of webinars on various topics. The first day being the first day, our distinguished scholars and professors and many, many stalwarts in the field of adult education as well as the extension, rural extension services. It really, I'm very privileged today to welcome our distinguished guests. First of all, I welcome our Vice Chancellor, Dr. T.T. Ranganathan. He has been serving here for the past 40 years in Gandhigram University, and he is an exponent scholar in the field of agriculture and one of the very, very pioneering personalities and almost a scientist in the agriculture field. And now he is the Vice Chancellor in charge of the late Gandhigram Rural Institute. I welcome you, sir, wholeheartedly for presiding the presidential address for the today's program in the morning. I also welcome the great personality, yet another great personality, Sri K.C. Chowdhury. Formerly, he was heading the Indian Adult Education Association as the president and general secretary. He really is a very, very towering personality in the field of extension. Has been running an NGO in Mau.
Sir?
Yes. Yes.
Sir, there is a network issue. Please be wait.
Okay, no problem. No problem.
Oh, yes.
And now, Dr. P. Muthuraman. He is one of our alumni.
Sir, it is not clear.
Yeah, it's clear.
Raja, sir, please, it is not clear, sir.
It is clear.
I don't know what is happening. Hello, am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir, please.
Yeah. Dr. B. Muthuraman, he is the principal scientist and head training and technology transfer, ICR, Indian Institute of Rice Research, Hyderabad. I'm very happy that Dr. Muthuraman is joining us, and he's one of our alumni and a great scientist in the field of technology transfer in ICR domain. I'm really happy, sir, to welcome you and to give this special address today for this important program. I also welcome our my own colleague, Dr. Venkat Ravi, Associate Professor and Director in charge of the Extension Education. He is one of the organizers of this program, and he has been involving in all the extension activities of GRI, Gandhigram Rural Institute. I welcome you, Dr. Venkat Ravi, sir, for having joined us and going to propose the word of thanks for this today's program. I welcome Dr. Jnana Saranya, who is anchoring and, you know, coordinating and a beautiful interreligious song you sang. I welcome you, Dr. Saranya, for this program. I welcome all the distinguished personalities, professors, senior scientists, and students from various universities in SV University in Andhra Pradesh and Madras University Department of Adult Continuing Education and Extension, and also Alappa University students, and here in Bharathidasan University students. I am really happy that this program being organized by both the Indian Adult Education Association and the Adult Continuing Education Extension, or now it's a lifelong learning and extension. I just wanted to set the ball on the court. Today's topic is strategies to face challenges in rural extension. It's a very, very important topic today, because rural extension is one of the iconic experience and expertise being produced by the Gandhigram Rural Institute and experimented by the Indian Adult Education Association through its organizations and branches in all over the country. Each state have the branches, and through the life members of the Indian Adult Education Association, the extension services and extension activities are being carried out all over India. So these great institutions like Indian Adult Education Association and Gandhigram Rural Institute, especially the Department of Lifelong Learning, is really experienced one and having a lot of success stories in the field of extension, rural extension. Rural extension, why we chose this topic? Because of the science and technological era, we have been facing a lot of challenges. Like, we had last 2 years, we have been facing a lot of problems due to the pandemic. But thanks to the science and technology and the scientists who really found that even this webinar is being organized all over India, even there are people who joined us at the international level also, it is possible because of the webinar. Without meeting each other, but we are able to exchange our ideas and knowledge. So the global perspective on extension is no longer that of unified public sector service, but of a multi-institutional network of knowledge and information support for rural people. This reality and its ensuing issues were discussed at an international workshop on extension and rural development, and the major challenges identified were decentralized system number one, privatization and extension education, demand-driven approaches to agriculture extension, revitalizations within public sector service, and last one is national strategy and reform process. So extension needs to be, and in many cases is more broadly conceived than has understood. And traditionally, this has been practiced, but now the new outlook is much more important. It requires government to undertake broader plans for designing and implementing extension services. There are three areas which I'm just only quoting. With that, I will complete my welcome address. The first one is home economic extension. Now we say that the financial literacy, we talk about the financial literacy through the self-help groups, like home economic extension services that target form women, self-help groups, and nutritious health education and welfare activities. The second one is extension services related to the agriculture production, core agenda, and including marketing, environmental conservation, and farm organizing development. Thirdly, services related to rural development. This is the most comprehensive and very, very important area for rural development in general, including off-farm employment opportunities and general adult education. So this is where we struck, and this is where we come together to fight it out and to meet the challenges and with the strategies. So I'm quite sure today that the institutional tie-up and institutional linkage and institutional coming together to work for rural extension programs. And I have a very distinguished scientist with us, Dr. P. Muthuraman, and also other distinguished persons are here to say and to exchange ideas and knowledge. There is a slight change in our program, and it's a last minute change, and I request our K.C. Chaudhary sir to preside over the meeting instead of felicitations, because our vice chancellor, he is in a very important meeting, but he would join us in later stage. But to to go ahead with this, I request our KC Chaudhary sir to preside over the the today's series of lecture. So now over to KC Chaudhary sir. KC Chaudhary, as I said earlier, now over to Jnana Saranya. This is the little child.
Yes, sir.
And over
yes,
to
sir.
You to take care of it. Thank
yes,
you.
Sir. Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you for welcoming our dignitaries and all. May I request Dr. KC Chaudhary, advisor, Indian Adult Education Association, New Delhi, with us. And he was the former president of Indian Adult Education Association and a well-known scholar in the field of adult education. It is fortunate to have your presence on this important occasion, and it would be befitting to have your blessings on the occasion. May I request Dr. KC Chaudhary for inaugurating the program. Please, sir.
Chaudhary sir, please unmute kar lijiye. Unmute.
Sir, it is unmute. Please unmute and come to the line.
Sir. Hello. Chaudhary sir, aap unmute kar lijiye.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Am I audible?
Yeah, it is audible, sir. Please get
on. Good morning, friends. This is my pride privilege to join this meeting. And first of all, Dr. L. Raja, convener of the program, Dr. T. T. Ranganathan, in charge vice chancellor, Dr. P. Muthuraman, principal scientist, training and technology transfer, ICAR, Indian Institute of Rice Research, Hyderabad, and my friend, Dr. Ravi. First of all, I would like to congratulate the university, Dr. Raja, and department to have this important subject for discussion. In fact, rural technology is very important subject, and we have been not giving due importance to this field. So I must congratulate the university to take up this issue of the rural extension and rural technology, which is very necessary. You see, our 70% economy is dependent on agriculture, and we do not give enough importance to the agriculture. You saw, as Dr. Raja mentioned, that for 2 years our parliament could not come because of the farmers' movement, and they were for some purpose, and later on those bills were withdrawn. So the exploitation is maximum in this field. The farmers are not getting proper price of their produce. They are living in a very bad position. Nobody comes to their rescue. Even when they grow something, they will get very cheap price. But when it goes to the market, the middleman wants double or triple than the original price. So this is one way where the extension activity should go. And we should think that they should get proper price of their agricultural produces. This is in Japan, where they have a federation of marketing the things. The government itself procures, and the prices are good, more than reasonable profit. So there should, once our leader, Dr. Ram Manohar Lohia, told that there should not be difference of the prices from one crop to another crop of more than 6%. So we should limit the profit of the middlemen. We should eliminate the middlemen. That should be the least, at maximum one middleman. That is. So this is a challenge before the adult education people, as well as the universities and higher institutions of learning. I think Dr. Muthurangan will, Raman will tell us about this. I would like to welcome on behalf of Indian Adult Education Association and the GRI also. And he will be guiding us on this important aspect. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir, for your very short and sweet message and inaugurating the program. Being a very senior most person, and we need your blessings for the successful of this program. And we are happy that you joined us. And you know, before introducing Muthuraman sir, there are 45 to 50 people joined in the you know, webinar, and in the YouTube there are more than 120 people they have joined. So we have more people to listen to us, and I think this is a very important topic, and Dr. Muthuraman would be able to succeed and would be able to make this as a more successful one. Now over to Jnana Saranya, please.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your kind words and blessings. And we are looking forward from you, sir. Now, it's the time to introduce the guest speaker of the day. We request Dr. Venkat Ravi, sir, Associate Professor, Department of Lifelong Learning and Extension, to introduce the chief guest. Sir, please.
Thank you very much. And I am very happy to introduce today's guest speaker, Professor P. Muthuraman, the senior scientist, principal scientist in the Indian Institute of Rice Research. He is also heading the Department of Transfer of Technology, and he is basically a social scientist. We are proud to say that he is the product of Gandhigram Rural Institute. He has worked in several institutions connected with agricultural extension, and he has also worked in Northeast region for a long time. And he has been continuously writing in the many journals connected with civil service preparation. And he's taken his doctorate from Hyderabad Central University. As a sociologist, he is very much concerned with rural and agricultural extension, and is not only a teacher, and he is a practicing man, and he has trained many institutions and in many agricultural universities. He has been coordinating with many programs, and he has also benefited by the JACA Fellowship. And now it is proud to have Professor Muthuraman the first day to talk about the rural extension and agricultural extension. And while we are discussing, myself and my colleague in the department, Professor Raja, when we initiated the discussion with Muthuraman, he himself has come forward and he said that he'd be pitching on the challenges and strategies in the rural and agricultural extension. It is, we are proudly presenting one of our alumni of GRI as the expert in the field of rural and agricultural extension. As a principal scientist, he will be the befitting person to talk about that topic. May I invite Professor Muthuraman to deliver his lecture. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Now it's the time for Dr. P. Muthuraman, Principal Scientist, Indian Rice Research Institute. Sir, we are very grateful to you as we have an opportunity to hear a wonderful lecture by you, which is testimony for the multidisciplinary personality. Please, sir. Sir, please unmute. Unmute your mic, sir.
Please unmute your mic, Muthuraman, sir.
Sir, please unmute. Sir, please unmute your mic.
They are doing it, I think. Please wait.
Yes.
You have technological problems. Well, we talk about the positive.
Okay.
Thing about the technology, but yeah, sometimes it is also a problem. Technical problems arises in technological domain.
Okay, can we press now? For that?
Is it audible now?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Please, sir.
I can proceed further.
Yes, please.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Please. Okay. Very good morning to everybody. Dr. Jnana Saranya, guest faculty.
Good morning, sir.
Center for Lifelong Learning. Professor Raja, my senior in the Gandhikram Rural University. I owe him as my teacher, friend, philosopher, guide, mentor, and so on and so forth. Dr. Venkat Ravi, my valuable colleague, also my classmate for 5 years in the early 80s of last century, also happened to be my roommate. I learned many things from him, including rural extension. In fact, he got the gold medal instituted by NABARD for the best extension worker at the time of 1984 convocation. Then Professor Ranganath, T.T. Ranganathan, Honorable Vice Chancellor Acting of this university, also my teacher. In the fifth semester, we were exposed to some courses in agriculture and animal husbandry. I remember Professor Chellamuthu, Vijay Kumar, Subramaniam, and Ranganathan, and Professor Gopal, they taught us some course, result of which today I am in the exalted ARS service. Though they taught us very brief period, we learned a lot from them. And Dr. K.C. Chaudhary, Advisor, Indian Adult Education Program, and getting felicitated today from my alma mater. It is a very prestigious moment to share the meeting with Professor K.C. Chaudhary. While introducing Professor Raja, said he is from Mahou. There are two Mahou. One is Mahou in Madhya Pradesh. That is the birthplace of the great personality, Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, who made the Indian Constitution. Another Mahou is in Houston, UP. Where our two major institutes are there, Directorate of Seed Research and the Agriculturally Important Microorganism. I don't know from which Mahou. Anyhow, whatever Mahou, it is a great place and a great personality from a great place. And dear all the professors of this university and research scholars, students, ladies and gentlemen, I feel I am a privileged one to be asked to deliver a lecture. Today is the busiest day. Actually, my director asked me to go to National Center for Agricultural Extension Management, Rajendra Nagar. There are colleagues are assembled there to discuss about the future of rain-fed farming. Also, two personal exigencies. A colleague of mine, she lost her father, but I have to go there. But for me, my alma mater is very, very important. Even if Venkatravi has requested me today morning 10 o'clock also, I would have obliged it. Because what I am today in the exalted ARS service, it is all because of the education by erudite professor of the rural university. So which forum will be better than this thing to express my gratitude to my university faculty members? With this thing, I take all of you for my PowerPoint presentation. I will be talking another 40 minutes or so about strategies to face the challenges in rural and agricultural extension. Actually, when we were in the rural university, we were taught about the rural extension by stalwarts like late Murugesan, late Professor R.S., Dr. Chellappa, then Dr. Borayan, Dr. Raja, and other great personalities. But I never thought this will put me in the profession of agricultural extension in the later stages. That has happened. I have forgotten rural extension long back. Now I am specializing only in the agricultural extension and technology transfer. In the country, rural extension has a very long history. After 1952, after launching the community development program, in the subsequent year, they have launched the National Extension Service. Also, they have appointed two of the Mehta committees by Balwant Rai Mehta and Ashok Mehta committee. They have advocated the democratic decentralization to the rural masses, which also comes under Panchayat Raj and the Rural Extension Service. Earlier in the local government at the black level, there used to be an officer exclusively for the extension activities called a extension officer of Panchayat or extension officer. Then
sir, please unmute. There is one, yeah, please unmute and talk. Yes, not yet been unmuted. I think while talking, it just goes like that.
Okay, Saranya.
It is okay. Please carry on. Carry on, sir.
Okay. Okay, is it okay now, sir, Professor Raja?
It's okay, please carry on. Okay, and okay. Ask somebody to be with you until you...
Yeah. My colleague, Dr. Arun is with me.
Yeah, please ask him to be with you.
Today, I will be talking another 45 minutes or so about the strategies to face the rural and agricultural extension. So mostly now, my specialization is towards agricultural extension. But in a country like India, there is a wafer thin difference between rural and agricultural extension, because majority of the people in the rural area still practice agriculture and allied activities, which is related to agricultural extension. So we cannot make a clear-cut demarcation in the Indian villages, what is rural extension and what is agricultural extension. So what is the difference between the agricultural extension and rural extensions? This stuff I got it from one of the World Bank publication. Agricultural extension provides information to farmers and passes to the farmers new ideas developed by agricultural research stations. Agricultural extension program cover a broad area including improved crop varieties, better livestock control, improved water management, and control of weeds, pests, and other plant diseases. Agricultural extension provides the indispensable elements to farmers to improve their agricultural productivity and profit. Whereas rural extension, the tasks associated with the rural extension includes micro enterprises development, non-formal literary education, family planning, health, and other non-agricultural area. So in India, mostly the agriculturist in off-season, they depend on these micro enterprises and other non-agricultural activities. So both agriculture extension and rural extension in Indian context need to go in a parallel track. The purpose of agricultural extension, here I have made it like a positive, comparative and superlative degrees. How it is? The only purpose of agriculture extension is to disseminate information to raise the production and profitability of the farmers. In a broader interpretation, in a comparative sense, the purpose of agricultural extension is to advance not alone productive knowledge, but the whole range of agricultural development tasks, such as credit, supplies, marketing, and markets. In nutshell, it is called the agricultural process development. In the broadest interpretation of agricultural extension provides non-formal agricultural related continuing adult education for multiple clientele for various purposes. So this clientele involved in agricultural development, research development, group promotion, and cooperative organizational development. So the agricultural knowledge triangle, it involves like this only: research, research to education, education to extension, and it will be keep on going like a cycle. And all these things focus on the central point of the farmers. This is called agricultural triangle. So education contributes to farmers' development, extension contributes to farmers' development, research. And it is having a reciprocal relationship, okay, like a symbiotic relationship. Each one will give and receive something. Ultimately, all these components, three components, help the farming community. Agricultural system as knowledge system. This is what the World Bank and other Bretton Woods organizations in the 80s, they have revealed this thing. Agricultural extension operates within a broader called AKIS, Agricultural Knowledge and Information System for Rural Development. The three pillars of the system, the previous slides I have shown, research, extension, and agricultural higher education. This is known as Agricultural Knowledge Triangle. These three are sequenced as a system rather than as a separate entities. So we cannot see them in a watertight compartment. Agricultural knowledge and information system could play a very central role in developing research and extension development program towards wider society issues, which can be expected to expand. So agricultural extension is part of the agriculture knowledge system or agricultural knowledge and information system. Agricultural knowledge information system for rural development link people with the institutions to promote learning and to generate, share, and use agriculture-related technology, knowledge, and information. The system integrates farmers, scientists, and extensionists, enabling them to harness knowledge and information from various sources to improve the farming and rural livelihood. Agricultural Knowledge and Information System for Rural Development, generally AKIS for RD combine rural with agricultural goals, because rural development involves both farm related and non-farm related activities, as I said earlier. Most of the extension programs in Asia, Africa, and Latin American countries promote both agriculture and rural extension together. They are both sides of the same coin. There are 8 approaches used in the extension. This is suggested by, advocated by George Axin. These alternate approaches used in the extension arena, this covers both agricultural and rural extension. One is general agricultural extension approach. This is just to disseminate the technology and make the farmers to step up the production, and they can get maximum profit and productivity out of the crops they are cultivating. Then commodity specialized approach, for some specific commodity they have devised the extension approach. In India, under the Ministry of Commerce, many boards are there, like a coffee board, rubber board, tobacco board. They are using this type of commodity specialized approach. In international level also, in Kenya and Guatemala, all they use this type of approach for coffee production. In case of Malaysia, they use this commodity approach for oil palm and rubber. Like that, different countries for specific commodities they are using. In Congo, and other places they are using for cocoa development, they are using this commodity development approach. This is very helpful for the farmers cultivating the commercial crop to get the maximum benefit out of it. Then in the 80s, training and visit approach was advocated by Daniel Benner, and in India they have implemented first in the Kosi Command area. Later the program was implemented throughout the country. It ran up to 1988. Once the World Bank Fund ceased to exist, the program has come to an end. This program was very, very useful to the farmers because of its single line command and fortnightly training. Though some critics have criticized, this is not a training and visit approach, but a touch and vanish approach. So some bitter critic, hypercritic, they have advocated like that, but certainly training and visit program helped to break the yield constraints in the agricultural arena. Then participatory approach. In late 80s and early 90s, the World Bank and other organizations, they have advocated the participatory approach. Farmers cannot be taken as a technology consumers. They have been taken as a co-researchers. So go to the farmers, learn from them, and when you are developing a technology, include the farmers as a co-researchers. This type of participatory approach has come initially from the Central International Potato Research Institute, Lima, Peru, then the CIMIT, International Maize and Wheat Research Institute from Mexico. Subsequently, it is copied by most of the national extension program. In India also, this program was incorporated with the help of ICR. Then project approach.
Sir, excuse me, please.
Yes, please.
Sir, your presentation is not visible, the PPT. Sorry for the interruption.
Yeah, it's not moving, that's it.
Yes, sir, please continue. Now it is visible, sir.
The problem is he has already unmuted. Muted.
Yes, sir.
Unmute, Muthuraman, sir.
Sir, I'm giving message. He may able to continue.
He has to unmute. Yeah,
he's connecting on another camera.
Yes, sir. Please.
Is it okay now, Saranya?
Yes, sir. Is it audible, sir?
Is it visible too?
No, sir.
Dr. Muthuraman, your presentation is not visible. And your presentation, only first page was there. It was not moving. Now nothing is there.
Okay, Dr. Pichai, nice to see you.
I'm hiding, sir.
Is it okay now?
Yes, sir.
It's okay. Yeah.
Okay. So fifth one is the project approach. It is used for the specific project. For example, to implement the dryland project and all. Yeah. In between, if any problem, please alert me. Saranya.
Yes, sir.
If any problem, please alert me.
Yes, sir.
So this project approach used for a special projects. Like when we implemented the watershed development project to mitigate the drought related things, this type of approach used. And whenever there is an epidemic in the rice pest or any pest or locust to control, this project approach was used. And this was very successful and it is time bound one. Then farming system and development research. In the 90s, they thought agriculture is not agriculture alone. It has been taken farm as a whole, including animal husbandry, dairy, horticulture, silvipasture, inland fisheries and all. So most of the World Bank and other Asian Development Bank, these people are asked to adopt this approach, farming system approach. It is called FSR&D, Farming System Research and Extension Approach. Here I have used the farming system and development approach. This was very useful that time. Then cost sharing approach. Sometimes what happens, some of the farmers, they are willing to share for the extension cost. Mostly the rich farmers, those who are cultivating the high value crops, whenever they need the technical advice, they are willing to part away the extension cost. So this approach also very useful. I have seen in Haryana and all, farmers are cultivating by using the greenhouse, this greenhouse technology to cultivate the high value crops like capsicum and all. So they used to give part of the extension cost to the private players. This is called the cost sharing approach. Then the educational institution approach. Suppose if the extension is imparted from some of the educational institution and schools to educate the farmers, this approach is used. Mostly the farmer field school and all, they have used this approach for the farmers. So research extension linkage. Late people have started talking about research extension linkage is missing. So the principle of agricultural extension receives relevant information from the agricultural educational system and feedback the field observation to the system. Okay. This relationship between agriculture extension and agriculture research is even closer because the knowledge that agriculture extension transfer is usually generated by the research through applied and adaptive agriculture research development. Initially, they have advocated only the research extension linkages, missing like that in the 70s. Then in the 80s, they started speaking about research extension and farmer linkage. They have extended one more, that continuum continued up to the farmer. Now people are telling research extension, farmer and market linkage. Today, every farmer is more, be it a small farmer or marginal farmer, because some of the populist measures used by the government for the household consumption, they are getting their food, grain, pulses, edible oil, sugar, everything from the public distribution system. Even small and marginal farmers also producing for the market. They want profit. So now they are advocating the research extension, farmer and market linkage. So the major challenges agricultural extension today, which we are facing, is about the human resource development. Human resource development means if you see the extension person available for farmer is very high in India. It is somewhere 1:7,000 or 8,000. By any standard, it is very, very high. We are not focusing on this thing, human resource development. Also, the people, those who join in the black level as extension officer or in agriculture research service or in the state department, land department or extension officer, they spend roughly 30 to 35 years. Hardly they will be exposed to one or two trainings. They don't know the latest development happened in the agriculture sector of different crops and all that thing. Also, we don't have the qualified human resources to impart the technology through the agriculture transfer. This area we have to focus. Most of the line department in different states, they have stopped recruiting these agricultural extension officers. Okay, and in the Krishi Vigyan Kendra also, no way different from the state department. I happen to visit many Krishi Vigyan Kendras. Whenever we go, the subject matter specialist position will be always vacant. If it's 10 posts are sanctioned, hardly 3 or 4 will be vacant. This is very bad signal they are giving. Then linkages, a little ago we have talked, we have to make the linkage with the other systems. Then only the agriculture extension will be very vibrant and the technology developed will percolate at the end user level. Finances, again the finance also, government if you see, agriculture itself will get very, very less from the overall GDP. In that, again, allocation to agriculture extension is very, very less. So is the case with the State Department. Most of the KVKs are getting finance under the central sector scheme. Again, Atma Agricultural Technology Management, they are also getting money from the central scheme to the state. So the amount allotted for agriculture extension or rural extension is very, very meager. This is yet another area we have to focus. Then about policy and governance. We don't have a sound policy and a local governance to take care of the agricultural extension activities. Then market linkages is very, very poor.
Sir?
In this remark, yes?
Sir, excuse me. Sir, yeah. Please, can you change the slide?
Madam?
Can you change this slide?
This slide is not visible.
Not visible. It is visible, sir.
Huh?
It is visible, sir, but it is a previous. It shows the previous one.
Now it's okay.
Now it is okay, sir.
Okay. So
please change the slide by slide presentation, sir. Presenting.
I am talking about that slide only. Okay. The major challenges in agricultural extension. I am talking about the component 5, market linkages. In his remark, he also said about a very poor market linkage. So if you see in Haryana and Punjab and all where the basmati rice growing areas, the farmers used to bring the basmati rice. If you go to the Kanna grain mandi or the Karnal grain mandi, they will be sitting days together to sell their produce. Okay, there is no good market linkage. Whether the farmers will gain or the sellers will gain or not, only the middlemen they used to gain. We need a very good market reform. We have advocated about the market extension also. Market extension, mostly we talk about the output market also. We have to talk about market linkages about the input market also. Somebody has said the farmers buy everything in the retail market, but the final produce they have to sell in the wholesale market. Somebody will come and fix the price. They are not getting. So if we make some value addition and all through the market, it will be very helpful. You see, tomato is a crop. Tomato is a crop, it is make or break. Today in Hyderabad, the tomato is sold for 150 rupees. And there are instances, the tomato was sold at 50 paise. As a mark of protest, farmers used to come and dump the tomatoes in front of the collector office and they will go. If there is a good market linkage with the value addition with the industry, these farmers' interest can be taken care of. Then about the infrastructure management, agricultural extension, it needs a very good infrastructure management. If you see, mobility is very much arrested among the line department people, rural department people. There used to be only one jeep. They cannot go to the village. The jeep is considered as the status symbol for the black development officers. So the others have to go with some two-wheelers and all. And they don't have much facilities to have the contact. Now we are writing a policy paper and we are advocating all the extension officers, rural extension officer, agriculture extension officer, or animal husbandry extension officer has to be given a mobile phone so that at the same time they can pump all the messages to all the farmers at a time. If there is any pest incidents or any cyclone, this thing, when the advisory can go to the farmers at a time, such type of infrastructure will help for rapid dissemination of the technology. Then our advisory system. Everyone is working in a watertight compartment, Atma, Samedi, KVK, ICR Research Institute, Line Department. So everybody will give different advice. So this what we want to do, we want to integrate them so that the advisory system will be very, very strong. Then empowerment of farmers. The farmers has to be included in most of the decision-making body, the KVK, Atma, Samiti, and all that thing, so that the farmer will have a sense of belongingness. Then private extension, now the time has come, we have to work with the private players. They will be more efficient in delivering their advisory and distributing the critical inputs, all these things to the farmers. These are the major challenges which we are facing right now. So here I am talking about little bit about the main feature of agricultural extension in the first green revolution, which started in 1965. That time the agricultural extension mainly focused on the food grains, particularly rice and wheat. They have ignored the other important crops grown in the rain-fed areas, particularly millets, minor millets, oil seeds and pulses, fodder crop and all. So this has created a disparity between the rich, well-to-do farmers and poor farmers. I suggest the audience, if time permits, kindly go through a book written by Vandana Shiva, the eco-feminist. The title of the book is Violence of Green Revolution, which give very clear-cut picture about how Green Revolution has created a disparity between the resource-rich and resource-poor farmers. Then in the second point is that time this extension people given in the advice to intensive use of water, fertilizer, pesticide and high yielding varieties. So more emphasis were given on water, fertilizer. Farmers have dumped a lot of synthetic fertilizers and pesticides, result of which now we are paying the heavy price. If you see, in the time of green at the time of green revolution, we had in the rice only 3 insect pests as major insect pest in rice, and only 1 or 2 diseases were there. Today 25 insect pests are there and around 15 diseases are there. This is all because of the non-judicial use of synthetic fertilizer and pesticides. Whatever the minor pest considered hitherto, all have become major pest. We call it in the scientific language, entomological language, as pest resurgence. They have developed a resistance. Because of the popularization of high yielding varieties, most of our native varieties has lost its importance. Then no focus on sustainability. That is the reason why we are facing all this problem. In India already we are having 5 lakh hectare coastal salinity. In addition to that thing, we are having 10,000 million hectare under inland salinity because we never adopted the sustainable agricultural practices. Result of which ICAR has established a institute at Karnal called CSSRA Karnal, Central Soil Salinity Research Institute. Now we are advocating mostly about the sustainable issues. This type of things have come in Japan some 100 years back. You must have heard about the name Masanobu Fukuoka, who has written a very famous book, One Straw Revolution. So he has mentioned, now we have to protect the natural resource base for our succeeding generation. Same thing now we are advocating about the sustainable agricultural practices. Again, going back to the native varieties, cultivating green manure crops, all that thing to protect the soil. Then benefited the resource rich and large farmers, these green revolutions. That time the extension advice was lopsided. It has ignored the small and marginal players. Then dependent on few technological options like hybrids and changes in the plant architecture. The plant architecture means before green revolutions, the plants, rice plant used to be very tall. By introducing a gene called DGU gene has come from Taiwan, the plant architecture was modified from very tall, it has become semi-dwarf, and it started responding to the high dose of fertilizer, pesticide, and other micronutrients. But after 40, 50 years, it started showing its ugly face. So today, again, the hybrids have come, result of which we have lost our native varieties and all. The former director of CRRI, he has emphasized about the importance of our native varieties. Our native varieties have very useful genes, which is incorporated in our breeding program to develop the new variety now. So the first line extension system of ICR, it is called the transfer of technology projects. There were 4 main transfer of technology projects of the ICR starting in 1964. The national demonstration project started. It emphasized on the major food crop, particularly rice and wheat. These crops were demonstrated at the farmer's field so that the other farmers, neighboring farmers, will be convinced about the production potential of the high-yielding varieties. So the technology started spreading from farmer to farmer. Then in 74-75, the ICR launched the operational research projects. Mostly it emphasized and the adaptive trials conducted on watershed basis. A cluster of villages, in a contiguous villages, it was taken and demonstrated this thing. Then the Krishi Vigyan Kendra in 1974, the first Krishi Vigyan Kendra was established at Pondicherry. Today almost 786 Krishi Vigyan Kendras are there in India. So this has helped to disseminate the agricultural extension services to the farmers at a very faster rate through various subject matter specialists ranging from agronomy, soil science, veterinary, fisheries, home science, agriculture engineers, processing engineers and all. This has helped the farmers because almost the farmers can approach each KVK. Even now we are not very happy. Our Director General Dr. Magapatra is telling now the KVK has to work very closely with the Atma so that they can work in a give and receive approach. Then lab to land program was initiated in 1979. Whatever the technology developed, most of the technologies were laying in the ICR lab or the state agriculture universities in the form of annual report, progress report, technical bulletin and all. This has to go to the farmers. They have initiated this lab to land program. Then again, they told land to lab also. We have to learn something from the farmers' knowledge and bring into the lab for technology refinement. In 1995, with the World Bank help, the technology assessment and refinement program started with the Village Link Program, IVLP we call in 1995, which he helped. Then the National Agricultural Technology Project in 1998, we have started. That has helped to refine the technology as well as the agriculture extension activities in most of the ICAR Institute and the State Agriculture University. Then the ATIC Center was established in 2000. It is called Agricultural Technology Information Center, mostly equipped with the State Agriculture University. It is a one-stop shop for all the agriculture-related information. Farmers can go and get it from there. Then in 2006, a National Agriculture Innovation Project was launched. World Bank has given almost like 1,000 crores. And this project, we have worked with multiple partners in a consortium. For example, in Indian Institute of Rice Research, we have developed one important portal for the extension activities called Rice Knowledge Management Portal. Like that, different institute has developed many mechanisms for the extension advisory services. So the changing scenario of agricultural extension, okay? In 70s and 80s, to increase total production by intensive agriculture was the main thrust of extension. But in 90s, the emphasis shifted towards technology development and due consideration to the farmers' needs and the use of indigenous technical knowledge to sustain the natural resources and to implement the scientific knowledge and other environmental concerns were the important thrust area of agriculture extension. So the current challenges in the Indian agriculture, the shrinking of resource base, particularly land resources is shrinking. When I joined in ICR in 1988, I used to read in the literature 43.5 million hectare arable land. Even today, people are writing the same thing. And you see everywhere the agriculture land has been converted for non-agriculture purposes. So there is no chance for any horizontal growth of agriculture, only vertical growth. So the shrinking resource base, how it has to be addressed by using the cutting edge technology like hybrid rice technology, agricultural biotechnology, all has to be used to address the resources. Then changing in the demand and consumption pattern. Today the purchasing power has increased for all the farmers. If you see in Hyderabad, if you go to the big corporate houses, those who are running like Metro, Heritage Press, Reliance Press, even people, those who are below poverty line also, they will come and buy value added products, dairy products, mushroom or processed chicken, all that thing. So the purchase power and consumption pattern is very changing at a very faster rate. This has to be addressed. So we have to advise the farmers to make value addition so that they can fulfill the consumer demand. Then changing in the farming systems. Now we are emphasizing about the diversification of high value crops. Then declining the public investment in agriculture. Government is spending very less on agriculture. At least last 40 years, we have not had any new irrigation project established by the government. So this type of thing, public investment is declining. Now you see important example, I will give you one very stunning example. In Telangana, last Monday and Tuesday, I was touring in Adilabad and Nizamabad. Surplus rice production. Surplus means very surplus, unimaginable. There is no storing places, no godowns. Scientifically established godowns are not there. Farmers are storing on the highways, national highways. So definitely they will get a problem like aflatoxin. The grain will get very quickly, it will be spoiled because of the torrential rain and all that thing. So now we have to, the government has to focus on establishing the godowns almost every block level. And some of the irrigation project, leave alone the major irrigation project, the minor irrigation project. And at times, we are not getting the labor. This government can establish the custom hiring services of agricultural machineries to complete the agricultural operation in time. As Jawaharlal Nehru has rightly said, everything else can wait, but not agriculture. So timeliness and precision is very important. This is important area. Government should invest a lot to develop the infrastructure facilities. Then international development. Today, India is a signatory of the WTO. So we have to make our agriculture more world level very competitive, particularly some of our products, it is we are exporting. For example, in the rice sector, if you take basmati rice, I always equate basmati rice equal to the dollar earning crops like the shrimps or cashew nut, but our basmati, when we are exporting to the European Economic Union countries, West Asia, Canada and America, they are comparing about the fungicide residue level and pesticide residue level. If the residue level is beyond the level advocated by this Cordes Alimentari, by this is given by this guideline is given by the Food and Agriculture Organization, they are not accepting. Immediately the consignment will be sent back to India. So this is another important area we have to focus. So the extension education people have to suggest the farmers about not to use a very harmful fungicide and pesticides. Then climate change, the climate is changing very, very fast. So our extension people have to educate the farmers. This is one of the current challenges. Hyderabad is situated in the Deccan Plateau. Generally, we receive monsoon in June 15th and June 15th. There are times we have received in October 15th. That time, farmers cannot raise the nursery and go for transplanting the rice. They have to immediately go for the direct sowing of the rice. So this year, if you see, Chennai has never witnessed this type of rain. In 70 years history, the climate is very changing very, very fast. So we have to advocate the farmers to adopt some of the climate smart agricultural technologies to overcome this problem. And the education people, extension education people have to play an important role in this area. So India today, this slide I have taken from my DDG in one of his presentation. He has mentioned, almost we have discussed about India's scenario. If you see, only we are using 4.2% of the world water, 2.4% of the world area is in India, 142 million hectare cultivated area. Okay, in that thing, net zone is only 63.6 million hectare. Our cropping intensity, it is 140%, and 52% of the population still earns their livelihood in agriculture. So here the agriculture extension, rural extension has to play a very, very important role. 13.8% of the GDP contribution coming from agriculture. Again, 14.1% earning from the total exports. My Director General, Dr. Mahapatra, always used to tell what ICR is giving, Government of India is giving to ICR. With one commodity, we are giving back to agriculture. In India, we are exporting 10,000 crore worth of basmati rice and another 10,000 worth of non-basmati rice. This two, one commodity alone, we are exporting, we are earning foreign exchange of 20,000 crores. Then you imagine about other things, about milk product, processed food, fruit, skin and hides, all that thing if you take, whatever Government of India is giving to ICR, we are giving back in manifold. But even then, the farmers are still facing problems. They are not getting enough profit. We have to make agriculture as industry. So whenever I used to go to the village also, farmers used to ask, sir, something is given to the industry. It is called incentives. But when they are giving to us, they are calling it as a subsidy. I talked to one of the top brass of ICR. He has very aptly put it. But the question is very nice you have raised. So today, if the iron and steel price is very cheap in China, we can ask the Tata company to stop the iron production of iron. We can import it from China. Can we do the same thing with our farmers? The rice is very cheap in Egypt, Australia, right? China. If we will import, you stop rice production. We cannot do that thing because agriculture is a state subject. If we force something, we are trampling with the farmers' fundamental rights. That's the reason when it goes to the industry, it is called incentives. When it comes to the farmers, it is called a subsidy. So the problems are plenty. We have to address that thing. Okay. So the agriculture extension towards the second green revolution. Now the second green revolution has started. Even Professor Emma Swaminathan is calling not second green revolution, we have to plan for an evergreen revolution. But some of the critics of Dr. Swaminathan, they are telling revolution will come once in a while. We cannot have evergreen revolution. So the second green revolution, we are focusing more on the gene revolutions. Okay, from a seed, now we have come to the gene revolution. Gene revolution means the advancement of biotechnology. Today, important biotechnology tools are there. Tissue culture crop is there. we have to popularize the farmers. Some of the transgenic crops are there. Farmers have their own inhibition to adopt some of the biotech product. In 1990, when I joined in this institute, that time this BT cotton has come, but farmers were very reluctant. They were up in arms. They were not adopting. But today, if you see, the entire cotton growing area of this subcontinent is occupied with 100% BT cotton. Slowly, the extension people have to educate the farmers about the advantages of having the biotechnology revolutions and using the gene and all. In I always cite one example. We have released our first biotech product called BPT-5204. There is a variety called BPT-5204 called Samba Masuri or Andhra Pony. This variety is highly susceptible to a disease called bacterial leaf blight disease. My present director, Dr. R.M. Sundaram, incidentally, he also happened to be from Tamil Nadu, my place, Tirunelveli. What he did, he has incorporated three genes called XA5, 13, and 21, were isolated from the Punjab rice variety and BPT-5204 rice variety by using the marker-assisted technology without sacrificing the quality. Today, it is 100% resistant to the bacterial leaf blight disease, and farmers are coming like a beeline. They are making a serpentine queue in front of IIRR and taking the variety, for which we have played a very important role as an extension scientist. We have used all the available tools to reach the farmers. So gene revolution is going to play a very important role. Now, the BT mustard developed by Professor Deepak Pandal, Vice Chancellor of the Delhi University, is ready, but the environmentalists are opposing. Again, BT Brinjal is ready, but people are opposing. But I heard our neighbor Bangladesh has already released the BT Brinjal, because we have the porous border in Tripura and West Bengal. Through that porous border, BT Brinjal has entered into the India. So we have to educate the farmers. When BT cotton came, media also wrote a very vituperative statement in the press. National bird died by eating BT cotton seeds like that. Such type of things we have to avoid. So the extension people have to play a very vital role to educate the farmers. Then emphasis on the use of biofertilizers. Now we have to advocate the farmers to go for organic fertilizers. For example, biofertilizer like blue-green algae, azolla, azoto factors, these also contribute a lot to reduce the dependency on the chemical fertilizers. For example, phosphatic fertilizer is very, very costly. When the Olympic was there in China, they stopped manufacturing the phosphoric acid, and the echo was felt in India. No company was manufacturing the phosphatic fertilizer because the raw material phosphoric acid was not coming from China. In International Rice Research Institute, they have identified some of the gene called the PUP1 gene. That gene is very good to take the phosphorus fertilizer from the soils. Now we are using that type of technology to develop PUP1 filled rice varieties. This thing has to go to the farmers. Then addressing the issue of sustainability, resource integration, and technology integrations, which we have discussed a little earlier. Then apply about the precision farming and mechanization. Labor is becoming a very, very big problem. So we have to go for the mechanization and the precision farming for land leveling, zero tillage, and all that thing. So if you see, India cannot go for rapid mechanization because the maize farmers are Africa are on par with the rice farmers of India. Basically, they are subsistence farmers. So small prototype equipments, we can advocate them to adopt, like a cono weeder, drum seeder, a knapsack sprayer, a reaper harvester. Such small machines we can advocate the farmers, which they can afford. When it comes to the big machineries like tractor or combined harvester, we have to make the custom hiring services. Here, the agricultural extension people have to act as a link between the nationalized bank and the progressive farmer groups to make the Raita Mitra group or farmers federation so that they can avail these facilities. Then linkage with the industry, market-driven and export-oriented agriculture. As I told a little while ago, even small and marginal farmers, today they are producing the things for the international market or the domestic market. So they have to have a link with this thing. The typical example is potato, tomato. Tomato, what happened? Farmers used to throw it when there is no price. Today it is selling at 150 rupees. At times it used to sell for 10 paise, 20 paise. That times if we link the farmers with the Kisan industry or some of the processing industry, then they can make the tomato and it can go for the ketchup industry. This also we have probed what happened. The industry want a tomato with a sour taste, but the farmers cultivate with a sweet taste. That
Muthuraman sir, please unmute your, please unmute. Unmute and talk. Please unmute.
Sir?
Unmute and talk. Unmute and talk.
It's okay, Saranya. Professor Raja.
Yes, sir.
Yes. Yeah,
yes, sir.
Clear.
Yes, sir.
Problem in your Google connection. Okay. Okay. Yeah. It's okay now.
Yes, sir. It is visible.
Okay. Okay. Audible also.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay. So another important area we have to focus is on the post-harvest food processing and value addition, then high quality in addition to increasing the quantity. Okay, that is important things. As I said, quality matters now. Then focus on the IPR and farmers issues, that intellectual property rights and the farmers rights we have to give important. So mostly what we are doing, the rice varieties and all the native varieties, we are making the farmers to register in the PPRV, FRV, so that the farmers will have their rights. Then integrate livestock, fisheries and allied enterprises with the crop productions. So farming should not be considered only as crop husbandry. It has to be taken as a system, farming system, so that if one enterprise fails, from other enterprise, they will get the benefit. Manage Hyderabad, National Center for Agricultural Extension Management. They have conducted a study. The farmers who are bestowed with the livestock, they have never committed suicide. Those who did only the monoculture, only crop husbandry, they have committed suicide. So this allied enterprises, whether it is livestock or fisheries or horticulture, this will act as a cushion, buffer for the farmers. Then exploit of the advances in the IT, the information technology has spread its tentacles everywhere. We have to take advantage of that thing. Today, every farmer is having the mobile phone. They are having the internet connections and all that thing. So the extension can use this telescience to reach the wider audience within less time. So the framework for strengthening agricultural system in agriculture, assessing the existing extension system and determine these have to be restructured or new initiative have to be launched. Broadening the technical knowledge in view of the current scenario. Here, the periodical training to the subject matter specialist will help them to abreast the latest knowledge. In turn, they can educate the farmers so that they can use the latest know-how and do-how in the farming. Then integrating the public, private and the civil society organization through PPP mode. Here, particularly the Reliance Group, ITC, then PepsiCo in Punjab, they have already started. For example, the typical example, a successful model has come from Gujarat. For example, National Dairy Development Board, then National Dairy Development Board, AMUL, and the local level farmers society, all these people are working together. That model is working very well. Few days, 3 or 4 days back or last week, when people have celebrated this Varghese Kurian birth anniversary, somebody has written in the business line, AMUL model has to be incorporated into the agricultural sector so that we can reap maximum benefit. Honestly speaking, I have seen only heading, I have not gone through. Definitely the substance must be very good. So such type of model has to be put. The public-private partnership is very successful in the highways, aviation sector and all, shipping, marine sector and all. We have to bring it into the agriculture sector so that our farmers can reap maximum benefit out of this partnership. It will be a win-win situation for all the stakeholders. Then development and application of ICT through the knowledge hubs. Many knowledge hubs have come using the hubs and spokes model so that people, the beneficiaries, can get many benefit out of it. One such a successful model has come from my institute, the Rice Knowledge Management Portal, which is helping almost every day around 200 to 300 people. They are coming to our portal. They are learning about all the rice related things. Such type of portal has come for many things like Yam Kisan, I Kisan, like that many portals have come, which is helping the farmers. Okay. Then location specific, participatory, gender sensitive and customized extension material and methodologies. Actually, in the 12th plan, they have given more emphasis on the gender mainstreaming of extension, also the participatory extensions. Now ICR has instructed all the extension activities has to incorporate the finer aspects of that thing. Like the technology is location specific, extension should be clientele specific. What methods you will use for the very big or landlords, that may not hold good for the small and marginal farmers. So location specific extension methodology we have to develop. For example, to the uneducated masses, that Rikin Gandhi has developed a video called Digital Green. These are making a very big revolution, and he was bestowed with the highest civilian award, one of the civilian award like Padma Shri. So we are using now video mediated extension to educate the farmers. Then effective linkages among the research, extension, farmer, market and other stakeholders. This I discussed in my earlier slide. Then farming systems and farmer participatory extension approach is need of the hour. Empowering farmers into the commodity groups. That is like now what we are doing, farmers producers organization. This is working very well. One such a successful model has come from the Tiruchi district, Nachanallur farmer producer organization. Such type of models should come for everywhere, then it will be very, very useful. Near Mysore also, the banana cultivating farmers have made the farmer producer organization, which is very successful. From Assam, we are getting some insights. The rice farmers, they are producing some black rice. Similarly, in UP, the farmer producer organizations, they are producing this black kala namak rice, which is having the medicinal value. This type of thing will be helping the farmers to sell their product at a profitable rate. Then changing needs of farmers for extension support. Now here I have raised some of the questions, how we are going to address, what technology options could be used profitably. There are plethora of technology, okay, basket full of technologies there. Which technology will be very useful for the farmers to make maximum profit? Such type of technology we have to advocate through our extension. How to manage various technologies? We have to tell the farmers how to manage all these technologies. So take the relevant technology. The farmers should be like the ANC and SPAN, but milk and water is mixed. They will take the milk like that. Only useful technology the farmers has to take. How and when to change the farming systems? For example, in Telangana and Andhra Pradesh, there is a burning problem now. Rabi season, the chief ministers of both the state, KCR and YS Jaganmohan Reddy, they are asking the farmers not to take up the rice cultivation because government is not going to procure, nor central government is not going to procure. Under these circumstances, what type of commodity they have to cultivate? So education, extension education people have to advocate the farmers. Definitely they will expect from the land department people what we have to do with our agriculture land. They are telling you go for a value-added crops like vegetable or pulses or oil seeds like that. But some lands which is suitable only for the rice cultivation, what we have to do? So this is an important area, how and when to change the farming systems. Then for what type of products is there a good demand in the market? Market intelligence or market extension has to play a very important role. They have to link with the farmer. They can do some market forecastings. Suppose if onion farmers, if they will cultivate after harvest, what would be the rate where they can sell? This type of advisory, it can be given to the farmers. What are the quality specification of the farmers so to achieve to get the good value? Now Reliance Fresh or Heritage Fresh or Metro, they will ask the farmers, but they will give the specification. If brinjal means it should be this color, this variety, this size, free from fruit borer, insect, all that thing. So this type of advice we have to give about quality specification so the farmers can get a maximum profit. If nothing is there, farmers can make even by cultivating the mushroom from paddy straw, they can give it to the shopper stop and all, they will get a very good price. We have to work on that aspect also. How to find quickly the most relevant information. So now many players are there. Krishi Vigyan Kendra, again, Atma, ICR Institute, State Agriculture University, Regional Research Station, NGOs, other civil society organization, Samiti and all, from where they can get the authentic information, that we have to educate the farmers. What are the feasible off-farm income generation options available? As I said earlier, during the off-season, farmers have to get something. So best thing is a dairy or any other commodities. As I said, the farmers who had animal husbandry as a component, they have never committed suicide. So like that, in the off-season, we have to educate the farmers. Mostly what is happening, they are going for the Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Program work only. That is only they are selling that labor. They have to be used to make some productive products, some good products, they can get more money. Then what are the consequences for his farming? If input subsidies are phased out or trade in agriculture is further liberated. Every day when we are opening the newspaper, our Honorable Prime Minister is telling we are giving this many lakhs crore for a urea subsidy in a phased manner, we want to withdraw like that. Now they are very firm. In a phased manner, they want to withdraw the urea subsidy. If that is the thing, how farmers are going to meet the nutrients required for their agriculture? Then further, if the trade is agriculture is liberated, how they are going to compete with the international market? This area extension has to play an important role. So this is some of the concept of custom hiring. Earlier I talked about to address the problem of labor by using the machinery. These small machineries farmers can purchase, and big machineries, they have to depend on the custom hiring. They have to go for an cooperative basis. Some of the critical issues in agricultural extension, one is farmer empowerment and farmers' organizational development. Then institutional issues, improve the integrated delivery support and services at the district and block levels through strengthening the capacity of improved interaction and joint functioning. As I said, multiple actors are playing the role, like KVK, Atma, Black Technology Team, then Farmer Interest Group and Agri Clinic, Panchayat Raj Institution. They all have to come together and they to work together. So an integrated delivery support is required. Then public-private partnership issue. I said already NDDP, ITC set good examples. This has to spread to the other area also. Then technology backstopping, integration and management. Improve the technological backstopping through partnership and contracting agreements. Frontier areas for extension, HRD and skill development. Weak extension in animal husbandry and fisheries sector. Very, very less professionally qualified extension people are there. Because today, fisheries and animal husbandry is part of the agriculture sector. So we have to strengthen here the human resource development so that they can play a vital role. Then assessment of quality extension personnel, periodical training to them about the latest development in agriculture and allied sectors, which help them to intend to educate the farmers. Then last sixth one is policy issues. That is, address the issues of enhanced funding, strengthen research in extension, establish a national extension authority like a Government of India has established a national rainfed water authority like that. We can establish a national extension authorities to study about the farmers' problem, developing strategies to improve sustainability and strengthen the mechanism for district level planning. I personally feel Professor Raja and his team can write a policy paper about how to strengthen the agriculture extension at the district level by making a micro level planning. Gandhikram Rural University is known for the micro-level planning expertise. So integrating nutrition with the extension, this is another important area, agriculture production and nutrition, increasing high quality food availability and access, nutrient rich and safe of own production, then agriculture income through nutrition, income from agriculture wages, commodity sales are being used to purchase more nutrient rich foods or services or products that support nutrition, okay, health services, etc. Then women empowerment in nutrition, okay? This is another important area, how agriculture affects women's social status and empowerment, women's time, and how it affects the woman health and the nutritional status. Role of extension in linking farmers to markets, which farmer, which market, okay? What type of farmers? All the farmers cannot be linked to market, and all the which markets, what is the suitable market, good markets where they can get remunerative price, what factors improve market performance, okay, quality control, value addition, all has to be focused. How does better market access help the farmers? How can we improve the market linkage, the extension and market linkage? Then can existing extension services do the job? Can this present extension setup can link the farmers to the market, or we need specialized extension people with the marketing extension specialization? Then this is about evaluation. Who needs the evaluation of extension? Where does the gap in our understanding? What works in extension? What do we measure when we evaluate extension? What methods and approaches work well? Earlier we discussed about the 8 approaches of extension by George Jackson. So which approach holds good for what type of farmers when it comes to evaluating extension? What have we learned from the instances where such methods and approaches have been applied? This is a framework for the technology development and delivery mechanisms, which is practiced in India. We have mentioned about the State Department, ICAR, all how they are working through different organizations like technology assessment here, KVKSA, and Journal Research Station, under that ATMA, then State Agriculture Universities, then Lion Department, BLAC, and the NGOs, Panchayat Raj Cooperatives and Civil Society Organization, ultimately reaching to the village level, then the farmers, whether this model holds good or we can redefine the model. So here I will touch about the Krishi Vigyan Kendra. This is a frontline extension model in the 12th plan. The vision is science and technology-led growth leading to enhanced productivity, profitability, and sustainability of agriculture. The mission is farmer-centric growth in agriculture and allied sectors through application of appropriate technology in specific agroecosystem perspective. The main mandate is technology assessment and demonstration for its adaptation and capacity. That is, they conduct an on-farm trial. Again, the proven technologies were demonstrated, and the expertise and the farmers were given competency through the capacity building activities, that is training, periodically they conduct. Okay. This is a little bit I will touch about information exchange from some of the agriculture extension approaches towards transfer of technology. Here you can see ATMA, Department of Agriculture, then ICAR. Then here farmer field school, then the state agriculture universities, how it is working about the farmer based organization and self-help groups, extension workers, KVKs, agri clinic. This is advocated by the manager. When it started, it was working very well. Now there is a sluggish in the agri clinic and agri business incubation centers. Okay, then input dealers, NGOs, and media and TV, each upheld by ICT, all these things are helping to the farmers, from farmers, traders, processor, wholesaler, retailer, and ultimately going to the consumers. And now for agriculture extension, we have to exploit the digital tool, digital extension for rapid technology transfer. Now extension has to spread over the cyberspace. Digital extension means using the power of online networks, computer communication, then the digital interactive multimedia facilitate the dissemination of agricultural technology. Almost most of the ICAR institutes, there is a separate wing for ICT. We have a special ADG, Assistant Director General for ICT, Information and Communication Technology. Now they are asking, in addition to the conventional extension method, we have to use the digital technology tools, okay? We cannot travel in the traditional pull cart in the information super highway. According to the time, we have to change. So we are working on that aspect, developing portal, decision support systems, drone technology, Internet of Things, all we are using now. So this is the digital tools for the rapid technology transfer exploited by ICAR. Here about this community radio, we are using participatory video. This is about the information kiosk we are using, drone technology for spraying. Today, business line also, they have given, Government of India is now thinking, Earlier, we used the drone for using the crop protection chemical. Now, even they want to make the fertilizer can be applied through this drone technology. Government of India is thinking very seriously. Then this is Internet of Thing. Here we are using about this. I'm not getting the name.
Sir, please unmute your mic.
The problem for him. Unmuting is the problem for him. There is some problem because he has to call somebody to unmute. See, come and see. Muthuraman sir, the time is already up. We'll come to conclusion. Is that okay? Because already time is passed. Yeah. He thought we have, if we have some time, we'll have an interaction, but still.
Yes, sir.
And I think over to Saranya, Jnana Saranya, please.
Saranya, is it visible?
Yeah, it is, sir.
Audible as well.
Yes, sir.
Yes, this sir. Is my humble submission, a constructive suggestion that Rural University, which is my alma mater, should incorporate a paper on community outreach and agricultural extension. This will helpful to produce employable graduates at the grassroots level in due course. So to conclude, I would like to quote, this is quoted by Dr. late Padmasri late M.V. Rao, our Special Director General and former Vice Chancellor of Andhra Pradesh Agriculture University. He learned this thing from the Nobel laureate Norman Borlaug. Research without extension is jolly because there is no accountability. You are not responsible to anybody. So if you do research without developing any technology, the extension is very jolly. At the same time, if you do extension without research, it is folly, foolishness. So both should have an accountability so that the end users, the farmers, will get benefit. So with this thing, I will conclude my presentation. If any queries are there, I would like to take wholeheartedly. Thank you for giving me an opportunity, Professor Raja, to deliver this lecture. I don't know how far I have convinced you people.
Yeah, it was so excellent, that Muthuraman sir.
Thank you, sir.
And it well drafted and well presented. And, you know, regarding the agriculture extension, you have really, made the wonderful presentation and also highlighted the technological intervention and the also what is the role of the Gandhigram Rural University to play a key role with regard to the extension activities. And we can spare a few minutes or even if someone would like to say something about any questions and queries or any suggestions, we will wait for a few minutes because there are a number of professors and others they have joined. Let us wait for a few minutes and then if there is any feedback, we will take it up and then we will proceed further towards part of thanks. Shall we do that?
Yeah, no problem.
Okay, thank you.
Another one hour or so, I am at your disposal, sir.
So, now, sir, please. Persons who participated in it and attended. So if you would like to raise any questions, you are most welcome. Anything to add also, you are most welcome. Thank you.
Yeah, there is a question. Can I?
Yeah.
Dr. Muthuraman, in fact, it was a wonderful presentation. In fact, last month we had a presentation in our department also. That was also appreciated by all the scholars, faculty, and students. And this was also excellent. I have to thank Raja Anna and also the team members for inviting you to make a presentation on this, right? Because I don't want to take much time. Second one, I have two questions to ask you. One is on the challenges you mentioned that private players have to be included private players have to be included. We have a lot of issues we have found because private players, we say that those intermediaries only benefit, but it is not going, the benefit is not reaching the farmers, and how an extension activity can be taken up in that one. And second one, this is first question. I made myself clear, I think.
Yeah, that's clear.
Right. The second question
crystal
is,
clear.
Yeah, second one is about the agricultural operations when you are mentioning. One is urbanization. There are, when I came to Hyderabad last month, I was in Sangareddy and also Rangareddy. You know that what is happening in the agricultural land. Almost it is converted into buildings and a lot of industries have come up and the agricultural operations are shrinking. And in fact, when we heard that land cost near to 40, 50 kilometers from Hyderabad, it is 1 acre is around 5 to 10 crores of rupees. It is amazing. So urbanization is one thing. Second one is labor problem. MGNR is NRGS. That is, people are going to that. That is second problem. And third one is that there is no youth involvement in the agricultural operations. It is also coming down. And as you said, indigenous and native spices are now become rare. We have not preserved or that attempt is not made in that. And particularly agricultural technology also. So how the extension is going to act in this circumstance? Thank you, please.
Yeah,
thank you.
Coming back to your first question about these private players, always they will have a profit as their sole motive, which is 100% true. We should have mutual trust, public sector and private sector, they should have a mutual trust. Some of the models in the, as I said earlier, in the highways, and the aviation sector, it is working very well. When it comes to agriculture, yes, there is a problem. In IIRR itself, we had a problem. When we released the improved Samba Masuri variety, Indian Institute of Rice Research, there are a lot of demand from the farmer side, but ours is not a seed producing company. But at the same time, our research result has to be translated and it has to reach the end users. So what we did, we signed a memorandum of understanding with some of the private companies. We have given our breeder seeds. They have to part away for every 1 kilogram of seed they sell, they have to give one rupee to us. This PPP worked very well initial 2 years. After that, the private people have started showing their own color. They said, no, sir, our profit is very bad. We are not getting much profit like that. And we had one separate conference also about this PPP in agriculture sector. And one of my young colleague, Dr. Arun, he worked about the hybrid rice sector. That time, one of the agriculture top press from our ICR, he told this private fellows what they will do. They will tell daytime, I will be wife. Nighttime, you will be wife, like that with the public sector, they will behave. They don't have any such things. It is there very much problem in their DNA itself. They want to make money like that. Somewhere we have to make a strict laws and all that thing, then only it will work. Coming back to the labor problem you have cited, Dr. Pichai, this is true actually what happened. Now what happened, the people are in, I used to go to the village and all when I used to interact with the farmers. The moment I will go there, I used to interact with the agriculture labor force working in MNREGA program, Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Program. The moment they will ask me my salary, what is your salary? I used to tell 1/5 of my salary. Even then they will develop acidity problems. Sir, you are coming in a AC car, taking mineral water, and you are getting this much salary. We have to toil in the hot sun, and we are getting, everybody aspiration is very high. Labor problem is there. What happened, that program, it is a government flagship program, we cannot criticize it, but it has derailed the agriculture operation in many places from Kashmir to Kanyakumari. Now the government of India is working out ICR, as an ICR part we have given our recommendations. Now government is telling, okay, you pay 50% of the labor wages, let them come and work in your field. but the laborers are not coming because there by 11 o'clock they will complete and they will go to the nearby Kallu compound to take the liquor. If they will come to the farmer's field, they have to work up to 5 o'clock, which they are not interested. It is a very, very big problem. If we are criticizing this thing, then people may think we are criticizing the government problem. Earlier, government also said you stop any program, but not certainly not Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Program. Let it be there like that. And if you see lakhs of lakhs and lakhs crores of rupees are allotted for this program, this is having some political motive, which I am not the person, competent person to comment. But overall, if you see that among the youngsters also, there is a decline to do agriculture. Surprisingly, there are some healthy signs now. Some of the people who worked in United States of America or Canada, they have quit this computer software job. Now they are doing agriculture. That is a healthy sign. Another thing, so now there are a lot of generation gap is there. Earlier when I was a high school, higher secondary school student, I used to work in my field till 6 o'clock. I cannot expect that thing from the present generation. ICR and Government of India has launched a program called ARIA, attracting and retaining the rural youth in agriculture and allied sector. But it holds good in the book. We have yet to make some of the thing. What happened if you give some populist measures like some incentives, like insurance and all, then they may come. This area, this is another important area which we have to work on it. This is not our view, it is the policy makers, they have to work on that thing. I said the problem quoted by you is very genuine, but we are also keeping our fingers crossed what to do with it. About the land issue, yeah, what is that Rangareddy district, it is namesake only, it is a district. It is surrounded by the Greater Municipal Corporation of Hyderabad, GHMC area. Only now real farmers are not there. Only people have become peri-urban farmers. They cultivate some of the flower plant and other things for the urban consumers. Sangareddy also the same problem. We are facing the same problem. Agriculture land has been diverted for non-agriculture activities. And the other day I was reading a paper about Kerala, a small strip of land, Kerala. There are 5 international airports in Thiruvananthapuram, Ernakulam, Calicut, Kananur, and one more place, Kananur, and one more place. Now they are planning one more airport in Sabarimala also. Major land is going like that only. So everywhere the problem we are facing, if you come to Hyderabad from the Indian Institute of Poultry Research, where Rajendra Nagar starts the agriculture research organization, from there to Megadipatnam, 1990 when I joined, these were full of paddy fields, pomegranate orchard and tomato garden. Today PV Narasimharao expressway has come, it has become a concrete jungle, it has been used. Even in Punjab, when Sarat Pawar was agriculture minister, one person, he directly pointed out it is better to convert agriculture field into the cricket ground or the marriage hall. That is much more
Dr. Muthuraman, sir.
Muthuraman, you are.
Yeah, again, it has been.
Again, the same problem.
Muted. Please unmute and talk.
Sir, please unmute and talk.
Saranya, I think
one minute,
we can go for
one minute, sir.
Yeah.
Sarana, is it okay?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
It's okay? Audible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay,
yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. Dr. Pichai, you are telling something?
Yes, please.
Yeah, go ahead.
No, that mine is over, I know, because I don't want to grab your time. It's as Rajanna said, we are just exceeded the time limit. So thank you. In fact, the answers which you gave is convincing, but still there are a lot of issues are there. That's one thing. And the second one is that the presentation, the flow, the references which you make, it's really amazing. Sometimes you make us envy of you. Thank you. Thank you for the
No, why envy? About one it at TV, yeah? Okay. Okay. Next.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Pichai, sir, for participating our program.
I would like to talk for a while with Professor Kailas Chaudhary. Namaste, Chaudhary sir. Namaste.
Chaudhary sir, unmute and talk.
And talk, sir.
Chaudhary sir, please unmute and talk. Yes.
Namaste, Chaudhary sir. Kaise?
Chaudhary sir, unmute kar, bol dijiye. I think.
Okay, no problem. Left.
Yeah, some technical.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, Saranya.
Okay, sir. Sir, shall we move on for a formal vote of thanks?
Okay, if there is no other question, we can go ahead.
Yeah, there is no question, but I just wanted to, thank before Dr. Venkatravi, thanks. And I really appreciate Dr. Muthuraman, sir. And it was so good and it was excellent. And you have really enumerated a lot of points which are very, very currently and current issues you discussed. And then also you gave a lot of strategies to overcome the present problems. And while I was introducing our friends, today's meeting, out of KC Chaudhary sir, all other members, Gyanasaranya, myself, and Muthuraman and Venkatravi, all are alumni. And when I had sent the invitation to one of our alumni in Sabarmati, her name is Sabarmati from Orissa.
Yeah, I know her. Padmasri Sabarmati.
Yes, recently she has been awarded by Government of India Padma Shri Award. She was an alumni of our institute, and she said that, sir, like Muthuraman sir, you have to invite all our alumni to explain about how Gandhigram University has helped us to, in our activities, to strengthen our activities through the extension activities. So at this juncture, I would like to, if she is joining, and I would like to thank her for the good idea. And we will be, enlisting a lot of our own alumni who are all in the higher realms, and they are really doing a lot of good work. So this is what I would like to say. Now over to Saranya for proposing further activities. Thank you.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Now it is the time to propose a formal vote of thanks by Dr. R. Venkatravi, Associate Professor, Department of Lifelong Learning and Extension, Gandhigram Rural Institute, and he is the program coordinator. Now it is over to Venkatravi, sir. Please.
The most difficult job in any forum is proposing vote of thanks. It has two kind of an difficulty. One is to make the person who proposes vote of thanks to be on the chat. And second thing is economizing the time. So I've been on the armchair, there is no problem. But I would like to first thank, as a life member of Indian Adult Education Association, our senior member and the senior president, he was till yesterday. Now he is having a role as an advisor to the Indian Adult Education Association, Dr. Kailas Chaudhary Saab. And we salute you from Gandhigram Rural Institute for helping us and ceremoniously inaugurating this program. And we are fortunate to have such an
highly scholarly figure to inaugurate this program. And we would like to go on record with the Indian Adult Education Association and the university that we are really fortunate to have your blessings and by way of inaugurating this program. At the same time, we would like to go on record registering our gratitude to officiating Vice Chancellor Professor K.T. Ranganathan. Sir,
Chaudhary Saab wants to say something, and if Chaudhary Saab, please unmute and say. Okay.
And always we are ready to listen to you, sir. And we would like to register our gratitude to our officiating Vice Chancellor Professor T.T. Ranganathan and Dr. V.P. Sivakumar, register for enabling us to have this forum and collaborate with Indian Adult Education Association and have a series of special lectures, which is an initiative by the Department of Lifelong Learning. And I thank the incumbent president, my senior colleague, Professor L. Raja, who is also heading our department, who is also the Dean of the School of Health Sciences and Rural Development, and he is the now having the role as the President of Indian Adult Education Association. Sir, we would be very thankful to you for, without your initiative and stewardship, it would be very difficult to have this kind of an event. It is just the beginning, and I think we would like to thank all the executive committee members of the Indian Adult Education Association and the present director, Dr. Kalpana Kaushik, and former director, Dr. V. Mohan Kumar Anna, for helping us to hammer such a collaboration. And we would like to thank, there are about 138 participants, distinguished participants through YouTube, and there are more than three dozens of participants through Google Meet, and many dignitaries and distinguished scholars are there, and we would like to thank all of them for joining with us. But not least, but I would like to thank one of my contemporaries and the senior scientist, agricultural scientist, and Professor Muthuraman. And when we requested him, wholeheartedly he said, I am ready, whatever may be the time, we are ready to spend for Gandhigram. And as an alumni, he has spent a lot of time, and he has hammered in such a way, and I hope this will be more useful for the postgraduate students and also the agricultural students and any science students who is interested in extension work. So, sir, we would like to thank, on behalf of the Institute and on behalf of the Indian Adult Education Association, for your valuable time and also demonstrating your multidisciplinary personality. And in the Gandhigram Rural Institute, I would like to thank, there are many HODs, professors and deans and scholars and faculty members who have joined with us and making this beginning as a grand success. On behalf of the department, we would like to thank all of you for sparing the time, even we have an examination schedule. So thank you very much, particularly to my two senior friends, Professor Pichai and Professor Manivel, who have been from the beginning with us, and thank you very much for being with us. And I would like to thank all the participants, all the scholars who could join with us for this today's event. I would like to thank the people who have off the screen worked for making this event, Mr. Venkatesh, Dr. Nyanasaraniya, and Dr. Ramesh, and many other secretarial staff in the department who could spare the time and have making this event a reality. And thank you very much. Thank you very much. It is only a beginning. I think we will go ahead with many other experts will be joining with us. And we will be waiting to meet you all again tomorrow morning on the same dais for listening to Dr. J. Jagannathan, Professor J. Jagannathan from Jammu Central University on role of youth in rural reconstruction. Bye bye. Thank you so much.
Bye.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Dr. Muthuraman.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.